views expressed on this program are those of the hosts, guests, and callers, and are not necessarily those of the station, its management, or other advertisers. You're listening to Transformation Talk Radio.
On the cutting edge of the new mainstream, Christine Upchurch is passionate about bringing together science, psychology, and spirituality in a way that can be applied to our everyday lives for true transformation. The Christine Upchurch Show, stellar conversations to illuminate your journey, engages some of the most inspired visionaries on the planet in lighthearted, lively dialogue. Join us as we explore the expansive nature of reality in a down-to-earth way, offering you insights and tools empowering you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Now, here's your host, Christine Upchurch.
Hello, everybody. Welcome. I'm so glad you're joining us here today, whether you're listening live here on KKNW AM 1150 radio, on Transformation Talk Radio around the world live, on one of the 90 stations that we're syndicated on, or perhaps after the fact on ChristineUpchurch.com. But whenever and wherever you're listening from today, you're going to be glad you joined us. I promise you. But before I give away who it is, I have to say hello to my better half here in the studio, who does the magic so that you can hear these wonderful conversations, Mr. Benny Mathers. Good morning, Benny.
Hi there, or good day, wherever you're at, Christine, and enjoying it. Yeah, just another one. We're getting underway.
Yes, we are. Yep. And we have a VIP guest.
We do. I rolled out the stanchions, the red carpet's all out, and I got to roll it back out. Oh, yeah. Busy day.
And he's been on the show before, and it's fun, Benny, because, you know, I think, okay, well, you know, he's done all this work, and now he's out teaching seminars and teaching to hundreds. They're sold out.
He's a busy boy.
That, you know, okay, well, that probably was his last book for now because he's too busy. And yet he always has more to say, and it gets more and more interesting each step of the game. And the person I'm talking about is Dr. Joe Dispenza. Joe is an international lecturer, a researcher, a corporate consultant, an author of several books, and an educator. And he's been invited to speak in more than 32 countries on five continents. He's a faculty member at Quantum University in Hawaii, the Omega Institute, Kripalu Center for Yoga and Health in Stockbridge, Massachusetts. And he is also an invited chair of the research committee at Life University in Atlanta, Georgia. He's a researcher, and he is a New York Times bestselling author. Several books, You Are the Placebo, Making Your Mind Matter, Breaking the Habit of Being Yourself, How to Lose Your Mind and Create a New One, and Evolve Your Brain, The Science of Changing Your Mind. And most recently, he's got a brand new book coming out in just a few days called Becoming Supernatural. He's also been in many, many films, including People vs. The State of Illusion, Down the Rabbit Hole, Sacred Journey of the Heart, and Heal, which is his most recent one. I would like to welcome Dr. Joe Dispenza. Hi, Joe. Welcome.
Thank you, Christine. Quite a introduction. I'm very happy to be with you again.
I'm grateful to have you here, Joe. And you know, I see how busy you are. I know many people who will go all over the world chasing you around because they have to be in your seminars. I go to sign up for one of your seminars and I see they're sold out left and right. And I've been very impressed with the information that you've shared in your previous books. And it's life-changing. So I have to ask you, Joe, why did you write this new book?
You know, in the last 5 years, Christine, one of the things that I began doing, because we were witnessing so many transformative experiences right during our workshops, our weekend workshops, you know, people with serious health conditions or, you know, past traumas, even from childhood, or profound mystical experiences or transcendental moments that were happening in real time, I decided that it was time to start measuring those subjective changes. And when you have a subjective experience, you know, a lot of times people say, oh, yeah, well, that's really great. But when you have a subjective experience that produces measurable objective changes, then something's happening right in the moment. So I gathered a team of scientists and researchers, and we began to quantitatively measure those changes in either what was brain function or heart function or genetic changes or neurotransmitters or the energy of the room or the energy around people's bodies, the energy center of their bodies, telomeres. I wanted to really begin to gain more information about what was happening in the inner world, person's thoughts and feelings. Mm-hmm. Now, we use meditation as a model to do that, as a model to transform. So I wanted to see people, changes take place. If they came to an event, we brain scanned them as an example. They went through 4.5 days of training, and at the end of the event, we scanned their brain again. And I wanted to know that the changes weren't just taking place in their mind, they were taking place in their brain.
Right.
But we were also measuring in real time a person's inner workings of what they were doing in their mind. And all of a sudden, in the last couple of years, we started making scientific history because we started capturing measurements in all areas of our objective studies. Mm-hmm. That weren't common, that weren't natural. In fact, they were supernatural, and so supernatural that I couldn't find any references to the type of the changes that we saw, as an example, in the brain, the amount of coherence in the brain, the amount of energy in the brain, the type of energy patterns that were produced in the brain. And all of a sudden, we started seeing these very specific trends going on with a lot of people that were, in fact, supernatural. Mm-hmm. So we now know that common people around the world can do the uncommon. And I think if you give people sound scientific information, and I think science is the contemporary language of mysticism, I think science demystifies the mystical, and those people can understand it in a simple way, they're making new connections in their brain. But then when you ask them to turn to the person next to them and explain it, mm-hmm. if they can explain the information, it's not wired in their brain, but if they can explain that model of understanding, they're beginning to install the neurological hardware in their brain to prepare them for the experience. So my thought is if you can get the person's behaviors to match their intentions and set up the conditions in their environment where they can apply that information, a certain percentage of those people are going to have some type of transformation. So my interest is in measuring that transformation and gathering more information to teach transformation again and to close the gap between knowledge and experience and the exploration, the process of discovery in witnessing so many transformative changes and the patterns that we saw, you know, proved to me that we are more than who we think we are, that it's not uncommon that people can begin to change their destiny, their health, their lives. And hopefully there's a more of a concrete and systematic approach to be able to do that. And if you were to ask me, 5 years ago, if I had ever planned on seeing the type of scientific discoveries that we've been finding, I would tell you maybe in 10 years or 20 years, or never even thought it was possible. So it's a great time, and I think if you give people the what and the why, the how gets easier. And my passion is not the philosophical realm, but really setting up events where people can experience their own true empowerment and greatness.
Right. And I really do want to get into some of the science here that you've just talked about. But first, can you share a story? Because I think that people think, okay, so maybe stuff in something called coherence or brainwaves or the energy surrounding a person may change. But how might that translate into the transformation and healing? And you've got some amazing stories. Could you please share one?
Oh, gosh. Well, I could carry on, but let's see. We had a woman that was in our workshops that was diagnosed with one of the worst type of breast cancers. Mm-hmm. She had never meditated in her life before. The type of cancer is a very aggressive cancer, and of course the treatment is a mastectomy and a very aggressive approach to chemotherapy and radiation. She's in her mid-40s, and she said, "Look, I'm gonna give myself a little bit of time here to see, before I make any radical approaches, if I could really turn the battleship around." And every day, every single day, she started lowering the volume to her stress hormones and continuously creating a new future by combining a clear intention with an elevated emotion. And in 3 months, all of her cancer was gone, no lumps, no cancer markers in her blood.
Wow.
In fact, she was she's from Mexico, and her family was very worried about her, so they asked her to go to the doctors in UCLA Medical College, University there. So she went, and the doctor said, "Well, you know, Mexican doctors really aren't that good. Mm-hmm. We've never seen a cancer like this ever turn around. Mm-hmm. They must have made a mistake." And to their surprise, they found that, in fact, that she was completely healed, and they have never seen a case like that before. So we have a lot of people reversing serious health conditions like that.
And this is really exciting. When we come back, Joe, I'm going to want you to talk a little bit about the science and give us some information about how the listeners can also become supernatural. More with Dr. Joe Dispenza here in just a few moments.
Tune in to The Truth Is Funny with Colette Stephan each Wednesday at 8 a.m. Pacific, 11 a.m. Eastern on TransformationTalkRadio.com. This hit show will have you thinking outside the box and riding the wave of infinite potential. Join Colette on the Higher Self Network, inspiring listeners to shine their brilliance and ensure success while roaring with laughter as they recognize the humor of the giant cosmic joke. Visit TheTruthIsFunny.com.
What is a brilliant culture? And how do we create them? Why are they important? Claudette Rowley has created a breakthrough five-step process to help you design a culture that is authentic, innovative, and successful. Learn how to create change with Cultural Brilliance Radio, the DNA of organizational excellence, and Claudette Rowley. To learn more or work with Claudette, visit ClaudetteRowley.com.
The goal for the Art of Powerful Living Radio is to inspire every human to live lives that are rich, fulfilling, on purpose, and fun. This hit show with Robert Schoenfeld is a fresh approach to boldly living our lives with creativity, courage, patience, wisdom, love, and power. Join Robert every month with Dr. Pat Basile for the Art of Powerful Living Radio.
On the cutting edge of the new mainstream, Christine Upchurch is passionate about bringing together science, psychology, and spirituality in a way that can be applied to our everyday lives for true transformation. The Christine Upchurch Show. Stellar conversations to illuminate your journey. Engages some of the most outstanding visionaries on the planet in lively dialogue to inspire you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Join Christine every Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific Time on KKNW, AM 1150, and Transformation Talk Radio.
I'm Christine Upchurch, and this is a Stellar Reflections Minute. Years ago, when facing cancer, without any immediate treatment options, I sought healing by making various life changes. For a while, I followed a very restrictive diet. I often found myself obsessing about which foods were good and which ones were bad. Then one day, I realized I was consuming foods based on fear of not getting well. But I didn't want to make choices out of fear anymore. I decided it was far better for my immune system if I allowed myself to experience the joy that came from, say, eating frozen yogurt, than it was for me to ingest the fear that came from avoiding it. Now, instead of choosing healthy habits based on fear, I try to make choices because they feel right and ultimately bring me joy and ease. How many of your healthy habits are really based on fear? Please visit StellarReflections.com or call 425-999-9836. That's 425-999-9836. Welcome back to the Christine Upchurch Show here on KKNW and Transformation Talk Radio. I'm having a conversation today with Dr. Joe Dispenza, and I'm so excited about his new book, Becoming Supernatural. Now, Joe, you know, you've talked a little bit about how you've been taking all these different types of scientific measurements of meditation. Now, first of all, I want to ask you, why meditation, and what is your approach to meditation?
Well, also, you know, one of the things that I love to do is demystify what meditation is. I mean, there's so many different types of meditation. There's so many different sects that practice meditation. And I really don't draw from any of those things. I draw behind what the science has to say and make the connection with the brain and the body. So let's see. You know, we know that when the hormones of stress are active in our body and we're living out of balance, and that's what stress is, living in survival, that the very chemicals that are created from stress begin to cause us to become materialists, and we begin to heighten our senses and pay attention to three things. When the rush of adrenaline happens, the body gets a rush of energy. So we wake up that we have to take care of our body. If there's a predator in the environment, our body becomes our main focus.
You bet.
Second thing is we look in the environment where we're going to go. I mean, where are we going to go to survive? And so the brain waves begin to change. And now the arousal from those chemicals causes us to pay attention to everything in our outer world. And we begin to narrow our focus on matter and on people, on bodies, on things and places, because that's where the danger is. And the third thing is time. When you're under the gun of the fight or flight nervous system, many times people are trying to predict the future based on the past. So the vigilance and the urgency that's created from the hormones of stress causes us to put a lot of attention on linear time.
Mm-hmm.
And so we begin to believe that we're a body living in an environment, living in linear time. And the more we put our attention on those three elements, the more we begin to become immersed in the dream of three-dimensional reality in Newtonian physics, where things take time to happen. So as you shift your attention from one person to one problem to one thing to another circumstance to another schedule, appointment, because of those chemicals that arouse the brain and body, every one of those things and objects and people and places has a neurological network in the brain. And so as we shift our attention quickly under those aroused states, we activate those different neurological networks, and all of a sudden our brain starts to fire very incoherently. Now, incoherence means a lack of rhythm, a lack of order. Different compartments of the brain that should be working together become more like a house divided against itself.
Hmm.
So it makes sense then, if you believe that your thoughts and feelings have something to do with your health or your life or your future, a new future that is, then it makes sense then that the best thing to do is to close your eyes and disconnect from your external environment.
Right.
Play soft music in the background so you're not distracted by your sensory input and connection to the outer world. Sit your body down and not eat anything, not taste anything, not smell anything. Don't move around and experience anything that creates certain feelings. And so then you're conditioning your body to be in the present moment instead of thinking about the predictable future or the familiar past. And it takes effort to settle down those three things, because so much of our attention is on our outer world. And the stronger the emotion that we have to certain problems or people in our life, the stronger the emotion, the more we pay attention to the cause of it. So mm-hmm. if where you place your attention is where you place your energy, you're giving a lot of power away to your outer world and very little energy for health, for creating a new reality, to creating a new future. And so we use the model of meditation so that the person can get beyond their body.
Mm-hmm.
And the body then has been conditioned to be the mind in most people because they've been in a habit of doing the same thing over and over again. So many people think their outer world is more real than their inner world because of those very hormones of stress. So then to overcome your environment and all the people and objects and things, and it requires a good amount of practice, and not anticipate the future based upon the past is also another habituation that we have to overcome. But when a person really does it properly, when they become nobody, no one, no thing, no where, and no time, that's the moment they become pure consciousness, and now they're settling into the eternal present moment. And according to the quantum model of reality, all possibilities exist in the eternal now. So in that elegant moment, the generous present moment, when they're not their face, they're not their body, they're not their wardrobe, they're not their weight, they're not their name, they're not their identity, they're not their profession, their social security number, they're not their schedule. That's the moment we really disconnect from this three-dimensional reality and we have access to possibility and potentials. The second thing is that meditation, the word in Tibetan, the symbol, means to become familiar with.
Uh-huh.
So if you're sitting in your meditation and you're becoming conscious of your unconscious thoughts, you're becoming aware of your automatic habits and behaviors, and you're noticing certain feelings, and instead of engaging in those thoughts, those behaviors, or emotions, you're observing them, becoming more conscious and familiar with them, it means you're less of a program, an unconscious program, and more consciousness. And now you begin to objectify your subjective self. So So it turns out that 95% of who we are by the time we're 35 years old is just a set of automatic behaviors and unconscious habits, emotional reactions, beliefs, perceptions, attitudes that function really like a subconscious computer program. So
that's 95%. That's shocking, Joe, because I know that there's so many people who are well over that age who really want to make, big transformation and change in their lives.
Yes, and it's just a blind spot because we've done something so many times. We've thought the same thoughts. We've demonstrated the same behaviors. We've made the same choices. We keep reproducing the same experiences that really create the same emotions. It makes sense then if you've done that for 10 or 20 or 30 years, the body now knows how to do it better than the mind. And when the body knows how to do it better than the mind, not only does the servant become the master, but now the body now is running the show. It's habituated. So now we lose our free will to a program, and our body's on autopilot, and it's dragging us to a predictable future based on what we've done in the past. So this isn't about positive thinking, because first thing you have to do is get into the operating system. And so meditation is a great way to get beyond the analytical mind. And what separates the conscious mind from the subconscious mind is the analytical mind. So teaching people how to regulate internal states and get beyond their conscious analytical thinking begins to cause them to change their brainwaves and enter the very realm where they can make substantial changes. Mm-hmm. By the same means, once they do, that they're so conscious of how unconscious they've been, they're so conscious that they would never go unconscious again, now they begin to change. So then the next question is, let's become familiar with some new thoughts. Let's fire and wire those thoughts in our brain. Let's begin to plan and demonstrate and rehearse in our mind who we want to be when we open our eyes. Well, the latest research in neuroscience says if you keep reviewing and rehearsing an action in your mind, your brain doesn't know the difference between the outer world and the inner world. And in the moment, you begin to install the neurological hardware in your brain to look like the experience has already happened.
Okay, so give us an example. Give us an example of that, Joe.
Okay, so if you keep doing it over and over again, the hardware will become a software program. Mm-hmm. So now it becomes more familiar and automatic. So the research shows that you take a group of people that never played the piano before.
Okay.
You divide them into two categories. One group of people, you teach them one-handed scales and chords. They come for 2 hours a day for 5 days. They practice those scales and chords every single day. Mm-hmm. They do a brain scan on them before they learn the activity and the brain scan at the end of 5 days. At the end of 5 days, those people who learn those scales and chords and play them every day install new neurological circuits in their brain because they learn new things. Learning is making new connections. They got some instruction. When you get some instruction, you get your body involved. When you get your body involved, you have a new experience. Experience enriches the brain. Mm-hmm. You pay attention to what you're doing. Paying attention is important because you're being present. And if you repeat it, you keep firing and wiring. So it makes sense that you begin to create new neural architecture.
Right.
But in the other group, you do the same exact thing, but instead of them physically just demonstrating the scales and chords, you have them mentally rehearse playing the piano in their mind 2 hours a day for 5 days. At the end of 5 days, they've installed the same circuits in their brain to look like they've been playing the piano for 5 days, like the experience has already happened.
I love that.
But they never lifted a finger. So now the brain is no longer a record of the past. Now it's a map to the future. You take those people, you set them in front of a piano, and without ever playing the piano before, they can play the scales and chords because they prime their brain to the future. So imagine you want to be a more patient parent. Imagine you want to be a more healthy person. Imagine you want to be a better leader. The act of rehearsing it then over time, if you keep doing it over and over again, it begins to become familiar to you. So the last step then is, can you teach your body emotionally what that future is going to feel like ahead of the actual experience? It means you can't wait for your wealth to feel abundance or worthiness. You can't wait for your success to feel empowerment. You can't wait for your healing to feel wholeness. You can't wait for your new relationship to feel love. That's waiting for something outside of us to take away our lack or emptiness inside of us. But in fact, when you begin to embrace your wholeness, your healing begins to start. When you begin to feel more worthy and abundant, you begin to generate wealth. Mm-hmm. When you begin to feel more empowered, now your body as the unconscious mind is believing, it's living in that future reality in the present moment. And now you're signaling new genes and new ways and you begin to change your body to look like the experience has already occurred. If you keep creating that emotional state and you trade lack or emptiness or suffering or pain for joy and inspiration or freedom, if you keep doing that over and over again, it'll begin to become familiar to you. And so how you think, how you act, and how you feel is called your personality. Uh-huh. And your personality creates your personal reality. So in order for you to change your personal reality, you have to change your personality. And it turns out that when people do this properly, not only do their bodies heal, but they begin to have those synchronicities, those serendipities, those uh-huh. coincidences, those opportunities to begin to show up in their life as a side effect of the internal changes that they begin to make. So then once they notice the changes inside of them that are producing the cause and the feedback in their outer world, they pay attention to what they do, and they do it with more passion. So we use meditation as the model of transformation.
Mm-hmm. And I know that your meditations, some of your meditations are very different than other ones that I'd experienced before, and I know you talk about them in your book. We're going to go to another quick break, but when we return, Joe, I'm going to want you to talk a little bit more about meditation, why you say the present moment is generous, and talk a little bit more about the science of what occurs in our bodies as we go through these processes. More with Dr. Joe Dispenza here in just a few moments.
Oh, I can see the future coming to you. Cry away the sadness in your eyes. And I can find a faith in days I've wasted. Being around enough to feel alive.
Isn't it time to put your health first? To give yourself the gift of whole body wellness? What if embracing unconditional love and self-care was the first step to wellness? Could you honor that for yourself? My name is Audrey Michelle, host of Rewired Life Radio and the author of Rewired Life, A Journey to Untangle Chronic Pain and Endometriosis. In my book, I share how I healed from 17 years of chronic pain and disease. Get your signed copy at audreymichelle.com/book, spelled MICHEL.com/book.
On the cutting edge of the new mainstream, Christine Upchurch is passionate about bringing together science, psychology, and spirituality in a way that can be applied to our everyday lives for true transformation. The Christine Upchurch Show, stellar conversations to illuminate your journey, engages some of the most outstanding visionaries on the planet in lively dialogue to inspire you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Join Christine every Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific Time on KKNW, AM 1150, and Transformation Talk Radio.
Did you know that all of the shows on the Transformation Radio Network are available as podcasts to stream or download?
Really?
Check us out. Go to transformationradio.fm. We have business shows, spiritual shows, energy healing shows, and pretty much everything in between. Something for everyone, guaranteed to inspire, educate, and transform. We are transforming the world, one listener at a time.
Have you been seeing numbers like 111 and 222 everywhere you go? Do you feel that the universe may be trying to get your attention, perhaps offering a message of some sort? As it turns out, numerical patterns and certain types of geometry form the very fabric of our reality, from cells under a microscope to the astronomy of our night sky. At Stellar Reflections, we offer special sessions which tap into these patterns, designed specifically to support you on your journey. The 111 and 222 activations are sessions activating new patterns in your energy field, which in turn can help you create new patterns in your life. After just one session with a practitioner, either in person or via distance, clients report gaining greater clarity, becoming more intuitive, and honoring their inner truth as they move forward in their lives. Curious about what these transformational sessions might do for you? Call 425-999-9836 or visit stellarreflections.com. That's stellarreflections.com.
Are you traveling most of your day? Do you want to take Transformation Talk Radio with you anywhere you go? Well, guess what? There's an app for that. Just go to the App Store on your Apple device or the Google Play Store on your Android and search Transformation Talk Radio. Catch all of our live shows no matter where you are. Thanks for listening.
For the battles we have won, for the day we reach the sun, gonna
Welcome back to the Christine Upchurch Show here on KKNW and Transformation Talk Radio. I am talking to Dr. Joe Dispenza, who's written a new book, and it will be out in a few days. You can pre-order it on Amazon, and it is called Becoming Supernatural. So, Joe, you know, you've talked about the importance of meditation, and I just love, there's somewhere in your book where you talk about the present moment as being generous. Why is that?
Well, again, based on our research, we now know that paying attention is being present. It's a skill. Mm-hmm. The more you practice it, the better you get at it. And there's a couple different types of attention. As I said before the break, that when we're in survival and we're in stress, those very chemicals that primitive nervous system begins to secrete causes us to narrow our focus on matter, on objects, on things, on our bodies, on people and places, because that's where our attention goes when we're threatened. But there's another type of focus that allows us to take our attention off our bodies and take our attention off of the people in our lives and the things we own and the objects that we're connected to and the place we're sitting or the place we need to go and our schedules and time. And it's called an open focus. And when we begin to close our eyes, instead of focusing narrowly, converging our attention, we begin to create what's called a divergent focus. Uh-huh. We begin to open up and take our attention off of matter and off the particle in quantum physics, and we put it on the wave or energy or nothing. The act of broadening our focus begins to cause different compartments of the brain that were once subdivided because of those chemicals begin to synchronize. And what sinks in the brain links in the brain, and all of a sudden the brain starts functioning more coherently. And it would be like an audience of 1,000 people, every fifth person clapping in rhythm. Uh-huh. That's the normal coherence in the brain. But if you stay there and you keep opening your focus, more neurons tend to join the crowd. So now maybe every second and third person along starts to clap, and now you have more coherence. And the more coherence you have, the more energy you have. And then sooner or later, you start seeing the entire audience of 1,000 people clapping. Wow, now you have super coherence and that kind of intense rhythm, along with the number of neurons that are working together, produces very high energy in the brain. So we now know when a person does that, they slip into that present moment, the generous present moment, and they all of a sudden, as I said before the break, go from a somebody to a nobody, from a someone to no one, from something to nothing, from somewhere to nowhere, from sometime to nowhere. And that's the moment they take their attention off three-dimensional reality, and now they're entering that field of information called the quantum field. Mm-hmm. And that field you can experience with your senses. Your senses plug you into three-dimensional reality. Right. You could only experience that quantum field with your awareness. And as you begin to pay attention to it, as you begin to stay present with it, as you begin to unfold deeper into it and pay more attention to it and experience it, each time you do, you begin to move closer and closer to that present moment. And a person reaches that moment where they're so present that their brain begins to become so coherent and so whole. We've seen this enough times, Christine, that the left side of the brain starts talking to the right side of the brain. Uh-huh. More real estate in the front of the brain starts synchronizing with real estate in the back of the brain. And all of a sudden, these two hemispheres come together, and the union of polarity, the union of duality, the union of opposites is called wholeness or love. And that moment, the person feels so whole and so complete, so in love with life, that it's impossible for them to want. I mean, how can you want when you feel whole? Uh-huh. When you feel whole, you feel like you have everything. Right. At the exact same time that that happens, while we're measuring a person's heart, when a person is out of balance, the heart is beating very arrhythmically. It's out of order as well. And the heart has its own little individual brain. And all of a sudden now, once that heart starts becoming more coherent because the person's feeling so much love and so much wholeness, wow, all of a sudden now the heart begins to send more information to the brain. It acts like an amplifier. Mm-hmm. And now the person starts to fall more in love with life. And so in that moment, heart begins to produce a measurable magnetic field up to 12 feet wide.
Wow.
That is energy. That's frequency. And when a person can take that energy and that frequency carries a message, lay an intent, a thought on that message, on that energy, they're beginning to change their own electromagnetic field. And we've measured that the field around the body tends to get broader. And now they're more energy and less matter, more wave and less particle. When we're reacting to the hormones of, with the hormones of stress to something in our outer environment or to our own personal thoughts, we're drawing from that field of energy and we're using the body's vital energy and turning it into chemistry. Our resources energetically begin to diminish, and now we feel more like matter and less like energy. When that happens, when we're matter trying to change matter in our lives, we force outcomes, we try to predict outcomes, we fight for outcomes, we control outcomes because we're matter trying to change matter.
Right.
The moment the heart opens and becomes more coherent, the brain becomes more coherent, now all of a sudden the person is producing a measurable, significant change in their energy. Now they can, when they change their energy in the present moment, they no longer try to force an outcome or predict an outcome. They feel like they already have it.
Uh-huh.
And when you feel like you already have it, you trust more and you relax more and you don't obsess and you don't analyze and you don't worry because you feel like it's already happened. And I think that for us is the natural state of being.
Now, you said that in that state, a person is more wave and less matter. Why is that important for transformation?
Well, in the research that I've done, I can tell you without a doubt that the ego doesn't change the ego, that the personality takes a long time to change the personality, that the program doesn't change the program. In fact, the brain doesn't even change the brain, that matter takes a long time to change matter. But in the elegant moment where you're truly present and you get beyond your associations to your body, your environment, and time, then you're moving beyond space and time. And that quantum field is an invisible field of information that exists beyond space and time. So once we kind of tap into that, we have now a release of energy. The body begins to gain information and energy because it's tapping into that field.
Uh-huh.
And so the body begins to expand, energy begins to expand, the person is tapping into something that begins to raise their energy. And I think when you change your energy, you change your life.
Uh-huh. Right. So, Joe, I know that in your book, you talk about a really profound story of your own mystical experience. And I love the fact that you, as a scientist, I know that you're connecting what, you know, used to be considered to be mystical, or some people actually have called it woo-woo, and you're linking the science to that. But I really appreciate that you have shared your own mysticism, your own mystical experience. Can you share with our listeners a little bit about that?
Okay. Well, I'll give it a start, hopefully before the commercial break, and then we'll probably have a time to finish it. But I'll tell you the background, and then I'll tell you the story. How's
okay,
that?
That sounds great.
I have always been chasing the mystical ever since I was young, because after you have one mystical experience that seems to be more real than anything you've ever experienced in your outer world, you can never go back to being the same person again, because the experience changes you.
Uh-huh.
But the experience isn't happening from some outer world experience. It's happening from your inner world, but it's the vision and the profound moment is more real than anything you've experienced before. Experience enriches the brain, and experience begins to produce an emotion, and you begin to get a biological upgrade, and I think some veil or some illusion begins to become lifted. A conditioning that we've had begins to break away, and we see reality better for what it is. So I had been interested in really demystifying that process, and if that happens, there's got to be biological systems in place that in fact created. So I had done an enormous amount of research on what the link is between that mystical moment and our own personal biology. And so it turns out that there's a tiny gland in the central back part of the brain called the pineal gland, or the pineal gland, it's pine cone shaped.
Right.
And the research shows that the pineal gland is a neuroendocrine transducer with piezoelectric properties. And that's just a lot of big words that
what
basically means it can take energy and frequency that's carrying information and descramble it into imagery and pictures. And that's what makes it called be called the third eye, because if you have an inner vision that is more real than any of your outer vision.
Right, right.
And I don't call it the third eye. I actually call it the first eye. So
I love that.
I was sitting there just after I had just written an article and realized that there are certain metabolites that are created in the pineal gland that are derivatives of the chemical called melatonin. And melatonin is a nighttime neurotransmitter. Mm-hmm. It is an antioxidant. It relaxes us. It causes our brain waves to change. It heals us as well. And it puts us into restorative sleep, and it creates dreaming. So, but when the pineal gland is beginning to take melatonin and transmute it into more different metabolites, I found some articles that show that it causes us to have very profound, mystical, and transcendent experiences. So I was interested in piecing that together. So I start off talking about how I just had done the research, and I was sitting on my couch, and I just closed my eyes. I had a busy day, and I just had to put my kids to bed, and there was a beautiful fire going, and it was dark, and I reviewed everything I had to do the next day, and I was just kind of sitting there looking in the fire and in trance, and I was relaxed, and I just closed my eyes, and I just said, "Where are you anyway?" Uh-huh. That was the thought that I had, and then I just kind of put my attention on where it was, and then the door opened. So I'll tell that story when we come back from the break.
All right, stay tuned for more with Dr. Joe.
Calling all moms, it's time to awaken your vibrant, intuitive, loving self in every area of your life. Join host Debbie Pokornik as she shares thoughts, stories, and tools to help you stand in your power. Listen to Vibrant, Powerful Moms helping everyday women create extraordinary lives, Mondays at 2:30 Pacific, 5:30 Eastern. For more information about Debbie, visit empoweringenergy.com. That's empowering with letters NRG.com.
This is Peggy Snow, practitioner at Stellar Reflections, with a Stellar Reflections Minute. So many people these days are trying to find ways to relieve their stress. What happens to our breathing when we're feeling overwhelmed and stress? When we tune in, we realize that we're either holding our breath or taking very shallow breath. To signal the body that all is well, which most of the time it is, sometimes all that is needed is a nice, deep breath to break the cycle. First, exhale to get all the stale air out by engaging the abdominal muscles and blowing gently. Next, take a nice full breath in, feeling it fill your body all the way down to your hips. Release fully and enjoy the freedom of movement. Notice how your body feels. Do you feel refreshed? Calmness is only a breath away. This has been a Stellar Reflections Minute. For more information about what we offer at Stellar Reflections, visit us at stellarreflections.com or call 425-999-9836. That's 425-999-9836.
Wow. Hey, everyone. Welcome. Welcome to the Dr. Pat Show. This is Talk Radio to Thrive By. I'm telling you, I got to pinch myself some days, because when each of us gets called to do something that we so not thought was in our wheelhouse to do for a purpose that's so much greater than us, we get to show up and shine.
If you would like to show up and shine on the Dr. Pat Show as a co-host or sponsor, send us an email to inspire@thedrpatshow.com. Is traditional medicine not working for you? Do you still feel as if your health isn't 100%? Here at the Holistic Medical Center, Dr. Nushin Darvish and the qualified staff look through the dimensions of wellness and start a healing plan prioritized to your needs. Our physicians assess the whole you until complete health is achieved. Get the help you need by visiting drdarvish.com or call 425-451-0404.
Are you stuck in unhealthy habits, toxic relationships, or low self-esteem? Do you crave a life of inspiration, love, self-acceptance, and fun? Sounds like you're on the verge. On the verge to your next big thing. Join Laura Richer, host of On the Verge Radio, helping you use your breakdown for a breakthrough, overcome life's greatest challenges, and live the life you want and deserve. Tune in each month on Transformation Talk Radio or visit SeattleHealingHypnosis.com for more information.
Your love, your
Welcome back to the Christine Upchurch Show. I've got Joe Dispenza here. And Joe, you were talking about the beginnings of your mystical experience, or one of your mystical experiences. And this one's fascinating to me because I got to read about it in your wonderful book called Becoming Supernatural. So, okay, so you're looking into the fire, and then what happens?
So I think I just had surrendered enough to not really anticipate or expect anything, and I kind of laid down my intellectual mind and analytical mind, and I just started wondering. And I think wondering is a great place, possibility, exploring, and I just just moved my awareness to where I thought the gland was in my brain. I just said, where are you anyway? And when you're in trance, you're less analytical. And when you're in trance, it kind of opens the door between the conscious mind and the subconscious mind. And I just kind of located it in my brain and just held my attention there for a few minutes. And then the next thing you know, I was sleepy enough but awake enough to get caught between wakefulness and sleep. And all of a sudden, very vividly, very clearly, I see this timepiece like a pocket watch, but very big and very bright, and it's right in my full view. And I, as soon as I see it, it fades, and I see this the knob-like structure with its mouth opened and releasing this milky substance. And I realize that in that moment that the pineal gland is like a timepiece, that we can travel forwards and backwards in time. I get the download. It wasn't like I had to think about it. I just understood that's what the pineal gland is, like a biological timepiece.
Right.
And it allows us to tune into information. So the timepiece all of a sudden starts to, the clock starts to wind back, the hands on the clock start moving backwards. And all of a sudden it fades, and there I am as a child, a seven-year-old child, and I was having a very, very high fever, like 105 fever. And when I was a child, I just loved fevers. I don't know why. I just loved having them because I would have these really profound dreams.
Yeah. It gets into an altered state. Yeah.
And I just knew that when I had them, that I just knew it was time to go inward. I don't, my mother and father would be worried, and I'd be like, oh, this is it. This is going to be good. And so there I am observing myself laying on my back with the covers right up to my bridge of my nose. And my mother had just left the room. And here I am kind of surrendering to this lucid state. And I'm looking at myself as my present self. And I'm watching this seven-year-old kid going deep into this realm and asking these questions about the nature of reality. And I was trying to, as a child, see reality like a chessboard, like there are different stacked realities that take place and they're all potentials. And I was, I had forgotten that I was at that time doing that, but I became aware that that's what I was doing. In that moment, I fell in love with this little guy, just thinking, wow, he's pretty deep, you know? And and in that moment that I felt love for him as my present self, the moment I felt love for him, I realized that it was my love for him in the present moment that was actually drawing that child, and his future was being drawn to me. I knew that time in that way was all happening simultaneously, and that it was my love for him that was drawing him to me, to the reality that I lived. So then all of a sudden the scene faded, and then all of a sudden here comes the timepiece, and it begins to unravel and go forward. And the next thing you know, I'm outside my house in my backyard in a November evening, and it's cold and there's frost on the ground. And I'm now in my backyard, but this time I'm my future self. I'm an upgraded version of myself. I'm more loving. God, I feel more conscious. I'm more awake and more alive. I feel whole, vibrant, and I've got this incredible amount of euphoria. The best way I could describe it is a joy for existence. I just had such a joy to be existing. And I was walking in November barefoot on this frozen grass. You know what the frozen grass looks like in the Northwest. I was walking barefoot on the frozen grass with this kind of loose garment on me. And when I walked and my feet touched the ground, there was no cold, there was no pain, there was no suffering. It was just the earth, and it was just pleasurable. And I loved the way it felt. There was no contraction from it. And Wow. I had walked across these basalt stones that I had built for this big fire pit, big, solid, huge stones. And when I put my feet on them and as I walked across them, I knew that they were noble beings. I don't know how else to say it, but I was connected to them and I could feel them and they could feel me. And I walked across them past a fountain. And it was a fountain that my brother and I had built in this cute little garden, beautiful fountain. And when I walked past the fountain, I saw this little tiny woman that was maybe 12 inches to 14 inches tall in a white garment dress come out, beautiful. And there was another woman like that was like a guardian or a protector of her that was standing next to her. And I turned and looked at this beautiful, luminous being, and she looked at me. And now when I was walking, I was thinking, God, I am in love with life. And when she looked at me, all of a sudden my heart just opened up tenfold. I felt more love than I could ever feel, that I thought I could ever feel. And I just remember thinking when I felt that feeling, I felt it in every single cell of my body. It was like a frequency, and it was coherent. And I just knew that there was always more love to experience. And I just kind of surrendered to it. And then I realized why I was there. I was there to connect with myself, who was in the present moment. Mm-hmm. And so I turned towards the window, and there I am in my house an hour before I laid down on the couch, and I'm washing dishes. And I could see myself washing dishes in my kitchen, and I'm my future self just looking at this guy, looking at him and seeing all his troubles and all his challenges, and I see his sincerity, and I see how he loves to dovetail different concepts and understand models, and I saw some of his future, and I just fell in love with this guy, and I just saw how sincere he was, and then in that instant, while I'm washing the dishes as my present self, I remember that while I was washing the dishes that I stopped for a moment because I felt this feeling like someone was watching me, and I felt this kind of feeling of love. And the light behind me was creating a reflection in the glass in the darkness. So I leaned forward through the reflection to look outside in the backyard to see if anybody was out there. And I remembered, oh, my God, now I know why I did that.
Right.
And then all of a sudden I realized that that when I fall in love with this guy, that it's my future self out in the yard that's calling my present self to me.
Oh,
and it was just a profound moment where I realized there was no past, there was no present, there is no future, that it's all happening in the present moment. And the only way that we actually connect to our future self that is more evolved and more enlightened and more loving and more whole is to actually be in that energy. And every day, if we choose that, I think we ultimately arrive at it.
Wow. What an amazing story. So in, I don't know, 30, 45 seconds or less, do you think that we all have the potential to have these kinds of mystical experiences?
Well, I now know we do, because not only have we induced those in our advanced workshops and our students, we also have measured what happens in the brain. And there's a very, very high amount of gamma brainwave patterns. The person's having a full-on sensory experience without using any of their senses. And if your senses are heightened, so are your awareness of the environment. And if your awareness is heightened, so is consciousness. And you can't have consciousness without energy. And the person is waking up in another realm. And that becomes more real. And this becomes more of the dream. And the pineal gland in the brain during that heightened moment is activated. The areas around the pineal gland that have to do with joyful emotional experiences that create long-term memory are called Brodmann Area 30 is also activated. And the energy is not the arousal from what's happening. It's not coming from a predator in the outer environment. It's coming from inside the limbic brain, inside the autonomic nervous system. And the person is transformed. They could never go back to being the same person again. So we can induce that state now.
So exciting, Joe. It's drjoedispenza.com, and Joe, I want to thank you for being on today, and I highly recommend your book, Becoming Supernatural. Thanks, Joe.
Thank you, Christine.
And thank you for joining us here. I look forward to talking to you again soon.
You've been listening to the Christine Upchurch Show, stellar conversations to illuminate your journey. Each week, this show engages some of the most outstanding visionaries on the planet in lively dialogue to inspire you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Join Christine every Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific Time on KKNW, AM 1150, and TransformationTalkRadio.com. For more information about the transformative healing work of Christine, visit www.StellarReflections.com. And for weekly topics, visit www.TransformationTalkRadio.com.